There is a huge misconception with regards to Shueisha and Shonen Jump, the great debate that has never really come to an overall conclusion, whether that's due to either mass amounts of misinformation or biased opinions as time gone by. For the majority of modern anime fans, Dragon Ball was the gateway for a large number of people, usually then followed up with one of the three series, One Piece, Naruto, or Bleach. Anime fans see the big three as opinionated or subjective in the Western world. When you think or discuss Shonen Jump's big three within the community or amongst other anime fans, you'll either think or get reference to Dragon Ball, Naruto, One Piece, and one of the most debated of them all, Bleach. As a fan of Bleach, this made me want to look into things much further and understand why this is such a misguided and misinformed stigma. And hopefully by the end of today's video, we will come to spread the notion that this idea of the quote-unquote the big three isn't just a ranking, but it is in fact a generational cycle that has been passed on throughout time, with more to it than just sales numbers and figures. So I think it boils down to two reasons. Number one, in America, the physical copies of Viz's own licensed versions of Shonen Jump magazine that released back in 2004 showcased Dragon Ball, One Piece, and Naruto together, despite the fact that Dragon Ball had officially ended in 1995, 2 years before the debut of One Piece in Japan, to which, as a young reader of the magazine, would allude that they were running simultaneously within the same generation. Number two, with the aforementioned series mentioned already, these were the first anime titles to really go mainstream, and I believe popularism of the childhood series leads to a conditional bias. Though unfortunately, as social media ramps up higher and higher during the 2012, and even throwing non-series like Fairy Tail and Attack on Titan was almost shared around as if it was a fact in regards to being in the big three with some of these titles. I want to try and create the most definitive, key word here, objective consensus in this video, or at least leave people with more knowledge and as well as look into people's perceptions regarding maybe My Hero or Black Clover as being a part of the new generational big three and who deserves to take the spot. So I think in order to talk about the big three and its generational past, we need to go back to where it all began, so we have a bigger understanding of what the big three is and its requirement for the title itself. With Shueisha's current marketing of the big three, I decided to go back and see where it all began. Shueisha has been very observant in its marketing towards the quote unquote big three in recent years and used this method of marketing as a staple in many of its events. For example, promoting the most relevant series of the year on Jump Festa billboards or using the most relevant mascots when opening up new pop-up shops or jump stores. These, however, were for singular years that are subject to constant change on a yearly basis depending on the trend or what's popular at that specific moment in time. So what about the Jump events as a whole? For example, maybe J-World or the History of Jump via exhibitions. Well, luckily for us, Shueisha's Jump has displayed this for us during its 50th anniversary. To commemorate Jump's success and tenure throughout its lifetime, it paid tribute to those that paved way into what Jump is today. And best of all, it displays this throughout the generation, giving us each a generation of Jump with the three most successful and influential at its forefront. The 80s, for example, providing us with Utako Ippiki Gekko Daisho, the Ideal Boys gang leader, Fist of the North Star and Dragon Ball. The 90s showcasing Dragon Ball Slam Dunk and Yu Hakusho, and finally the era of the 2000s with One Piece, Naruto and Bleach. In Japan, the Big Three wasn't technically called the Big Three. However, it was called the Golden Trio. So with that being slightly corrected, what in fact makes the Golden Trio or the Big Three? Let's take a deep dive, and as we explain the history, you will see a reoccurring pattern of achievements, consistency, success, and influence. Weekly Shonen Jump launched in 1968 and only became weekly a year later in 1969. During Jump's fourth ever issue to appear on shelves with Hiroshi Motomiya, who made his first work, to which then later resulted in his first debut to Jump serial, Otoko Ippiki Gakkai Daisho, in issue 11 of the same year, the series proved to be such a massive hit that the author was forced to extend his series past its original intended ending. It was because of these editorial changes that the ending of the series was turned into a promise of its return. Due to this success, Shueisha created what we see in today's modern Jump covers of the successful series being preferred to be on the front of the magazine, solidifying that the fact that the more a series gets on the Shonen Jump cover, the more it can be heavily inferred that it is due to the response of its audience. But then again, that should be a given. Otoko Ippiki Gakkai Daisho, or in simpler translation, the ideal boys gang leader, was to become the first quote-unquote pillar of Shueisha's new magazine, and a part of the first generation of Jump, putting Jump's first ever title on the map in 1968 and becoming the first series to get a collection of manga prints. In simple terms, the first generation itself became Jump's influence and staple of what the magazine would soon become, and in this era was when Jump's manga rise began. Despite the series starting in the late 60s, the author stayed with Jump until 1987, and thus the series did influence and inspire many young mangaka who would come to work for Jump, solidifying its status in Jump's first ever pillar to carry Jump as far as it did. This generation would then go to include a more recognisable series to whom this demographic of video is aimed towards, such as The Fist of the North Star. The Fist of the North Star, which debuted in 1983, introducing a mix of genres such as action, romance and drama to its readers, adding on to the popularity of Jump. And while I personally don't have much to say in regards to The Fist of the North Star, it would be very ignorant not to see why it was a pillar of Jump during this era of time, selling over 100 million copies, a feat only 10 Jump titles have achieved, while also introducing an era of influence with its storytelling, as well as popularized the trend in quote-unquote manly manga. With Fist of the North Star collecting a large amount of Shonen Jump magazine covers, I think you may know a familiar series that was then introduced into the scene. A little series called Dragon Ball.
Akira Toriyama, the creator of Dr. Slump, debuted what would become the cultural phenomenon and series everyone would come to love, Dragon Ball, which rose to fame in 1984 and kept its number one spot for 11 years. Besides being the second most sold manga not only from the magazine but worldwide, Dragon Ball was the first series from Jump to break out from Japan and become international. Although this didn't happen until the second generation of the Big Three, it was on the borderline of doing so before hitting the 90s, Dragon Ball single-handedly destroyed the competition, becoming front and center of the 20th anniversary of Jump's cover magazine, and then making Shueisha's Shonen Jump magazine the number one magazine in all of Japan. So that is the first generation, but it doesn't end there. Let's talk about the 90s. With the majority of series continuing or coming to a close, Dragon Ball was still going strong, transitioning into the adult Goku era known as Dragon Ball Z, going into the 90s with an iron fist, and growing with no sign of stopping. This was a series, after all, that managed to achieve more than 250 million sales alone in comics, not to mention how much in other media such as anime, countless video games and advertisements and merchandise, and every new series wanted to be like Dragon Ball, and it paved the way for the influence of the next generation that was to come. With plenty of evidence to back it up, that's become common knowledge. You don't have to be a manga historian to understand the impact of Dragon Ball. An example of such was when Tite Kubo was trying to publish his work into Jump magazine, saying in an interview that the chief editor, Mr. Torishima, handed over one volume of Dragon Ball and Fist of the North Star and told him to read this when he got home and draw such a manga. And even went on in other interviews when asked his favorite manga as a kid, he of course referenced Dragon Ball. This was Bleach's own Jump Ryu, and just like One Piece and Naruto's Jump Ryu, all cited the same thing. Dragon Ball inspired them all. And thus, Dragon Ball stays prominent even to this day, inspiring many of today's manga, including the 2000s millennial version of the Big Three. It was very obvious that Dragon Ball had thus become the staple of success that Shueisha wanted in their magazine, and they ended up making the right move.
Fun fact, it was also around this time too that I should mention the magazine was transitioning from group photos with the mangaka to eventually their mascots of their said series. This was due to a lot of new authors wishing to of course keep their privacy. However, this in turn resulted in a lot of marketing experimentation with Jump and its characters, and throughout the Jump covers you will notice more and more on how they make their most popular characters stand out more so than the rest, with trial and error to see how the format is in today's current Jump formula. By 1990s, Slam Dunk was a series which revolutionized sports anime, after Captain Tsubasa, which quickly dominated the magazine alongside Dragon Ball. Not to say Captain Tsubasa was never an influence as a sports manga, in fact it was very popular for its run. However, Slam Dunk, as well as Dragon Ball, broke numbers, becoming the 6th most sold shueisha manga with over 126 million copies, and as well as breaking into the international market, having a magazine collaboration covers with Shaquille O'Neal and Michael Jordan. The success of Slam Dunk even had such an influence in its increased popularity of basketball as a whole in Japan during the 1990s that this in fact consisted of a Slam Dunk scholarship program which was created in 2006 by Inoue and Shueisha. The winning 17 to 18 year old recipient receives a fully paid academic and athletic scholarship to a school in America if they pass the school administration interview. Interestingly enough, another series started in 1990, not long after Slam Dunk, called Yu Hakusho, which like Slam Dunk was an instant hit not only in Japan, but also in the States as well. Anime America Extra magazine even acknowledged the manga as one of the kings of popularity in the mid-1990s, supposedly having a mass availability from large bookstore chains to small train stations. Yu Hakusho unfortunately had a very small run in the magazine of only 4 years, ending very abruptly in 1994. It was said that Togashi, the author, had issues with deadlines and art inconsistencies, and from my assumption here, had a dispute with Shonen Jump. Whether this was about editorial changes, responsibilities, or anywhere in between, Yoshihiro Togashi ended the series on the spot of a story arc and handed his last chapter as pure character designs and told TV Tokyo how to end his anime. At the peak of Yu Yu Hakusho during that time, who knows how much bigger Hakusho could have been, but it stood with Dragon Ball and Slam Dunk for 3 years straight. And thus the 90s golden age power trio goes solidly to Dragon Ball, Slam Dunk and Yu Yu Hakusho. These three are historically regarded as Jump's golden trio in achieving the magazine's domestic prime sales records. Unfortunately, this was about to become a very dark turn. With Yu Yu Hakusho making an end in 1994, Shonen Jump lost another two pillars that held the company up. Though this was Jump's most successful period until they ultimately peaked in 1995 with over 6.5 million copies of Shonen Jump sold, it was also the era when many of the most consistent Jump authors of the 80s ultimately left the magazine. This was to really hit hard when the face of Jump, Dragon Ball, concluded, taking 500,000 readers along with it. Unfortunately, only a year later, Slam Dunk concluded, taking over 2 million. This of course led to an immediate and dramatic plunge in the magazine's readership. This was the end of the second generation of shonen manga that dominated the industry, garnering millions of copies per these pillars, which was the start of the quote-unquote the dark age for Shueisha's Shonen Jump magazine. With Jump scrambling to find the next big hit, it wasn't until the new era that rookie mangaka inspired by Dragon Ball began to work for Jump. And though they weren't hits right away, the only two manga able to properly compete with Dragon Ball's level of success during this time was being One Piece and Naruto, starting, of course, this era. So moving on to the third generation, where the golden trio became more clear and how we know it today, along with the growth of Shonen Jump itself. In 1997, the first pillar was eventually able to be replaced 2 years after Dragon Ball with a series called One Piece that quickly took the number one spot in manga and in the magazine. Honestly, it's One Piece. It's f***ing massive. Let's try and let you know why One Piece is a pillar of Jump. You ready for this? Cool. One Piece has had several volumes of the manga that have completely broken publishing records, including the highest initial print run of any book in Japan. It has set the Guinness World Record for the most copies published for the same comic book series by a singular author. As of April 2020, the manga had over 470 million copies in circulation in 43 countries worldwide, making it the best-selling manga series in history. It became the best-selling manga for the 11th consecutive year in 2018. One Piece is one of the highest grossing media franchises of all time, estimating to have generated more than $21 billion in total in franchise revenue from manga, anime, films, games, and of course, merchandise. Do you really need any more convincing? I mean, besides having the majority of Jump covers, that is. Oh, I forgot it also has its own pirate ship and dominated Tokyo Tower for a good 5 years. Anything One Piece, theme parks, restaurants, museums, you name it, it's all there. Or at least has been there. Though saying that, it did become a pillar domestically in Japan rather than internationally. That came rather later on, in fact. I can say that because One Piece's creator Eiichiro Oda even stated he envied this next series' popularity outside of Japan. So what did break in Japan and internationally was our second spot of our golden trio, being the Naruto series, taking the second spot in Shonen manga in 2000. Naruto is the fourth best-selling manga series in history, selling 250 million copies worldwide in 46 countries. It has become one of Viz Media's best-selling manga series, and the volumes have appeared in USA Today and the New York Times' bestsellers list several times. While I can see from experience why it definitely became popular in the West, it was very obvious from a younger age that Cartoon Network needed a replacement for the hit series Dragon Ball Z, and having a fighting ninja in an orange jumpsuit apparently was enough for us to resonate with Goku's orange gi, I suppose. With the new millennium, any remaining series and creators from Jump's golden age were mostly already gone, and with the new hits from the late 90s began to really take off. Jump was able to retain the same readership for consecutive years and only dipped slightly, and series like One Piece and Naruto were able to become the best-selling manga of their time. So, there you have it. We have broken every pillar in current Jump history, and it's time to conclude this segment. We finally have our third pillar of the 2000s, Bleach. Volumes of Bleach have sold more than 82 million copies in Japan and became one of the best-selling manga series in the United States. The anime adaptation has been similarly received. It was rated the fourth most popular anime television series in Japan of 2006 and held a position among the top 10 anime in the United States from 2006 to 2008. Bleach's anime was also able to accumulate close to 600,000 in DVD units in seasonal units alone, and won a plethora of awards as well, like its rivals One Piece and Naruto, breaking out and taking the West by storm. Though Bleach was never as quote-unquote popular in the US as Naruto, for example, most likely due to being on Cartoon Network and the other being on Adult Swim, critics had said that Bleach was less childish and simply comes together surprisingly well in its style and execution of what is a fairly standard material. In terms of demographics, Bleach appeals to a narrower international audience than Naruto due to its higher complexity of its plot, as well as due to the religious aspects of the story. Bleach stood on a pedestal with the other two most consistent mangas of the early 2000s as the third generation, with Naruto and One Piece. It was ranked at number 3 and signalled at the time of millennial growth in Shonen Jump. A member of the Big Three by the standards of today seems to be how memorable the series was, or how the culture of the series is still relevant. Bleach has proven to be a staple of not only the current anime climate, but to the writers of the manga prominent in the industry today. Examples of the quote-unquote Big Three being influential to now series in the magazines are as follows. Starting off with Jujutsu Kaisen. The French manga publisher Kion asked the author Gigi, or Gigi however you pronounce it, a question. What Jump series did you read originally? First Dragon Ball, then I read Naruto, One Piece, and then Bleach, which were the big three pillars for a long time. I was influenced by a lot of them. Kaizen's author also threw Kubo's name in respect for influence in a Jump Festa special chapter, which Jujutsu Kaisen is breaking a lot of numbers as of the recording of this video, even going as far as to straight up tell people to read Bleach in a Q&A in a Shonen Jump magazine page. The same applies to My Hero Academia's editor, Koike. When commenting on the success of My Hero Academia, he references that the series inspires many authors of today, and he uses the 2000s era, or the third generation of Big Three, as an example. A perfect reference to not only the authors who create the material in the magazine, but the employees at Shueisha who have seen the Big Three and its marketing and successful series firsthand. Speaking of My Hero Academia's author Hirokoshi, one of Jump's current top sellers in the magazine, he explains how Kubo was an inspiration for him, especially in terms of words and meaning, very much similar with Kubo's response on how Dragon Ball was to him when he was a reader of Jump. Oda and Kishimoto, One Piece and Naruto's authors, followed the same inspiration. A few more examples before I overbear my point. The series Act Age also had influence from Bleach and was often used as an almost secret code for explaining certain points in the series itself, for like scenarios or just random gags and whatnot, because both the mangaka and editor both enjoyed the series and they both understood the scenario and explanation of which the reference was related to. So I think that in and of itself is pretty cool. You can even go as far as to see references in Jump manga like Gintama and Bakuman. Bakuman is a series, or was a series in Jump, with the whole point of creating a story of two guys chasing the dream to be successful mangaka by the time that they reach the age of 18, using a lot of heavy reference to the big three generations, and more specifically, Bleach, One Piece and Naruto. I mean, it's even on their volume 2. I mean, it's right there in front of you. The author of Bone Collection, which unfortunately didn't last too long in Jump, he was excited and appreciative to even appear in the same magazine as his idol, as when Kubo came back to show off Burn the Witch, showing much respect not once, but twice in weeks his author comment section of the magazine. Current hopeful manga Mori King also pays respects with reference in his main story, making an inspirational or inspired reference line for line homage of Ichigo and Renju. So now we have come full circle. It's time to talk about what I meant when I said Shueisha has been very observant in its marketing towards the big three in recent years. One Piece, Naruto and Bleach have been used for many of Jump's current marketing strategies, like collaborating with Honda in its Honda Fit campaign or popular Japanese store Uniqlo. Granted, these are collaborations during Jump's 50th anniversary, they made it very apparent to sell Ichigo, Naruto and Luffy front and center of the generations, with Goku being placed as a kind of grandfather figure of the 2000s generation. They also used this opportunity to promote Jump Ryu, which was a collective of Jump's favourite and popular authors, which I will note, for whatever reason, the first 8 were planned and made public. The first 4 were publicly televised, and each issue following were arguably the best of the best in Jump, starting off with the biggest of the big, Dragon Ball, and the current big three, as we know, that were inspired and followed in Dragon Ball's footsteps. The opening of stores or exhibition events, you will always see Bleach, One Piece and Naruto, or even in-game apps like Aura Collection or, for example, Jump Paint. Things like Aura Collection or J-Star's Victory Versus or even Jump Force, I would mention, but these are highly contextual. For example, many people will bring up Jump Force, but Jump Force was promoted towards a westernized audience. And at the moment, you know, Dragon Ball, Naruto, and One Piece are currently, as it stands, the biggest in America right now. Maybe because Bleach had been off air for like 8 years. And to be honest, that was at a Microsoft event at E3. So yeah, completely different demographic. So yeah, to be honest, they really needed Dragon Ball to really push that game because Americans love Dragon Ball. In conclusion, the debate on who is in the big three is the trickiest one, because fundamentally, I would heavily assume that the majority of us watching this video don't live in Japan. We weren't there before the international nor digital age or era. I would personally conclude that there is more and more evidence and patterns to deny otherwise. Just unfortunately, we don't have a digital record of events and how the previous era was marketed outside of the magazine as outsiders. We can only look at the culture of the magazine, its marketing patterns and success, but even so, it's very obvious that there is a generation of big three, or the golden trio. Jump editors, Shueisha and Jump employees, including the mangakas, validate this. The marketing validate this, and sales and popularity make this pretty much, at this point, objective. So I believe that actually the most trickiest question of this video is, what is the new big three? It was very much come to my conclusion that the third generation consisted of the longest and untouchable in terms of consistent sales. The big three dominated sales rankings for years and can be said to be the result of a quick rise of the debated golden trio. As well as dominating the domestic popularity and sales, this generation all broke internationally and used the rise of internet culture to propel itself further than its contemporaries. Sure, we have big series that happen every year, but they never really touch the success that the big three did in the long term, and they never stay the mile. In simpler terms, unless the new big three series of whatever happens becomes the biggest thing on the moon, at this current moment in time, there is nothing a new generation can do to top or contribute higher than its last predecessors, besides maybe sales? But having random bursts is not what Shueisha is looking for in a pillar. They want the long term. So One Piece and My Hero is good for them, and chances are Deku will eventually be a face that replaces Luffy when One Piece finishes, but a big three like The Last Gen is so unlikely to be replaced, especially at this current moment in time. So I am going to leave it off with that, and I hope you did enjoy the video and this consensus of why the Big Three is an objective generational cycle. And of course, we should be talking about what can be the next Big Three, rather than talking about the previous Big Three that currently runs at this current moment in time. I want to give a big shout out to Geekdom for his bit within the video, and the people that have helped me along the way with researching and editing with this video too. If you want to see more videos like this, which take longer and more research time, please go check out my Patreon. Please go and support and show some love over there, and I will try my best to give you guys more quality content like this in the future. Please, of course, like and subscribe. Honestly, it's free. You have no excuse why you shouldn't do it. There is a Twitter as well if you want to suggest anything to me, or if you want to converse, or even better, there is a link in the description to a Discord channel as well if you want to speak in real time and also get your thoughts and opinions, and also join the community as well. So with that being said, I am going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day, been handsome, and as always, people, peace out.